Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box. Affordable, mind-enriching programs.
Gildan Media presents Digital Sense, the common sense approach to effectively blending social business strategy, marketing technology, and customer experience. Written by Travis Wright and Chris J. Snook. Read by Walter Dixon. Foreword. You are not a digital marketer, at least not yet. I want to use this foreword to officially warn you. You're in for a delightful experience. Normally, audiobooks that teach you so much aren't supposed to be this much fun to listen to, but that's Travis and Chris for you. They not only share their real-world experiences in shaping the future of digital, they do so in an engaging and entertaining way that keeps you laughing and learning. Now, with that said, let's go to work. We live in an era of digital Darwinism, a time when technology and society evolve. The question is, how are you, or how are you not, evolving to keep up with change? It's not an easy question to answer. There's an illusion that makes us believe that just because we are investing in new technologies and strategies, that we are ahead of the curve, that we're leading the way to the future of digital transformation because we use the same networks or apps as customers. But that doesn't make you a digital marketer. A digital marketer is someone who understands that to engage someone digitally, it must be done in a meaningful, personalized, and contextually plus culturally relevant manner. Digital marketers understand the dynamics of online sites, communities, and apps individually, not in the aggregate. And more so, they understand the human on the other side of the screen based on preferences, behaviors, values, intents, lifestyles, aspirations, and so on. As such, digital is a means to reach a different breed of customers, one who's connected, informed, empowered, demanding, elusive, a bit narcissistic, and definitely in control of their online experiences. Digital marketers, in the very least, are digitally literate and also empathetic, appreciating the extent of how people have changed and continue to do so. Only then can they design strategies, messages, content, and such that break the old chains and confines of traditional marketing and abolish the dated checklist and metric system many so-called digital, social, and mobile marketers rely upon today. There's a reason you're listening to this. It might be the same reason I wrote this. We're ready to sharpen our digital sense so we learn, and more importantly, unlearn, to grow and lead. In its purest form, that's digital sense. It's our ability to perceive outside inputs and assess new horizons and states that are driving the digital economy better than we do now. But it's also more than that. All of this is designed to help you be more in tune than your peers in grasping the gravity of change and to do the things that put you ahead of your competition. And more so, you're learning how to step outside of what you think your role is in marketing to actually lead your organization into a digital-first era. This is a story that's equally about changing the future of marketing as it is a story of personal transformation. The other reason I believe you're listening to this is because you possess something that others in your organization do not, the ability to see what others can't. And as such, you're then willing to do what others won't. We can't do any of this alone. And this is why you're part of a special group of people who share your passion for knowledge, who look for support from one another to blaze new trails, and who reassure one another in times of need. One of the greatest challenges we all face is the difficulty in getting others to recognize the importance of digital when they don't personally live a digital lifestyle. As such, it's impossible to feel the importance of digital in the future of brand and customer experience. Without empathy and belief, you will never have the support you need. And that's really the heart of the matter. Most executives don't live the brand the way customers do, yet they're responsible for driving business objectives and managing resources to achieve them. If you're waiting for someone to tell you what to do next, you're on the wrong side of innovation. That's why we're here together, right now. We're not waiting. We're leading the way. Listen to the book. Make a plan. Let's go. Observe. See the world differently without your personal filters. See people for their differences and let it all inspire you. Visualize. Define where it is you need to go versus where you are, and what success looks like both now and over time. Act. Start learning and unlearning the things necessary to achieve your milestones, and also help bring others on the path to transformation. Earn. You are more than a marketer. You are a change maker. And as such, you will write the future of marketing as you evolve and earn the support and accolades you deserve. Your partner in change, Brian Solis, provocateur, futurist, believer in new possibilities, at Brian Solis. That's at BRIANSOLIS. www.briansolis.com. That's BRIANSOLIS.com. Preface. A Tale of Two Tweeties. On September 9th, 2012, the Kansas City Chiefs lost to the Atlantic Falcons by a score of 40-24. The next evening, Travis was chatting with his buddy since fifth grade, Brian, and they were complaining about how the Chiefs were approximately $30 million under the salary cap for the fifth year in a row. Travis said, "You mean to tell me the Kansas City Chiefs have been approximately $100 to $130 million under the salary cap in the last 5 years? OMG, I'm so tweeting that." So, from his Twitter account, at TW, he sent this one tweet. "I'm not much of a at KC Chiefs fan anymore. Clark Hunt's yearly $30 million under the salary cap bullshit is unethical. Owners can F.O. CC at NFL. This was not a friendly tweet. Travis understands that. He was angry, as a fan, and decided to tweet about it. It was one glorious tweet from one gloriously disgruntled fan. It was only one rude tweet, not a barrage of tweets. As you'll soon find out from this audiobook, both Travis and Chris tackle the consequential and inconsequential in life and in business with strong opinions and tremendous fervor, with a balance of hilarity and humility that comes from an insatiable thirst for continued learning and teaching. After Travis complained about the salary cap on Twitter, he was over it. He sent that one tweet and went on his merry way. It wasn't until the next day at lunch that he looked through his Twitter direct messages. It was only then that he noticed the tweet from the Chiefs. He nearly choked on his delicious Chipotle burrito. Travis thought about it for a few minutes and then took a screen cap of the direct message. It said, "Would help if you had your facts straight. Your choice to be a fan. CC, get a clue." The Chiefs had sent this tweet just 3 minutes after Travis sent his rude, disgruntled tweet. Somebody from the Chiefs' social media team immediately tweeted to Travis while in an emotional state from the Chiefs' official Twitter handle, at KC Chiefs. Note, the Chiefs switched their official Twitter handle to at Chiefs in 2016. The Chiefs' social media manager didn't seem to have much digital sense. That person clearly gave zero Fs at that time. It was not a good common-sense approach to attack Travis. In fact, Travis wasn't even that angry. He was just sending out a bit of a rant regarding his displeasure with how the Chiefs were being cheap and spending significantly less than the salary cap. Jay Baer recently published a great book on this subject called Hug Your Haters. The Chiefs' social media team should have tried to defuse the situation, not fuel the flame. The first indicator that it would be wise to hug their hater was that at the time, Travis's account had more Twitter followers than the Chiefs. Digital bit. This is one reason why organizations should have social media governance policy in place for how to respond or prioritize tweets such as his. Listen for more digital bits and resource downloads throughout the audiobook. After seeing the emotionally charged response to his tweet, Travis did what any social media savvy person would do who had just had a crummy customer experience. He took the screen cap of the Chief's message and tweeted it out to his followers. This is where the social shitstorm started. Digital bit. If you send a private message via Twitter or Snapchat, it's not necessarily private. Anyone can can screenshot anything. Travis replied to the private direct message by sending out this tweet. It's good to know the @KCChief social media is ran by immature teenagers. Fact, Hunt hoards salary cap dollars. #KC. Whoever responded to Travis's tweet from the Chief's Twitter handle lacked both common sense and digital sense. He made a hasty assumption that it was appropriate to defend the Chiefs in private via direct message, indicating the absence of a social media governance policy. He lacked or ignored any protocol that would enable him to respond in real time, proactively to Travis's public complaint, in a way that allowed for a productive dialogue. He also failed to acknowledge that, in a world of noise, Travis's initial tweet was far less damaging to the Chief's image than was the tweet storm that followed. Listen to this data. The first tweet had 15 retweets. The follow-up had more than 3,200. The Chiefs had no social media governance policy in place to make a decision as to whether to respond at all, and it had big consequences. What did the social media manager have to gain by being rude back to a rude fan? Nothing, except the brief satisfaction of telling someone off. You can do that all day long on a personal account. However, if you do that on a corporate-branded account, get ready for some backlash. Keep in mind, in the beginning, Travis was just complaining. People bitch about their sports teams all the time. This was nothing out of the ordinary. Immediately after Travis publicly replied to the Chief's tweet, all hell broke loose. He received a bunch of responses, such as, TW, did the Chiefs actually send you that? And, are you serious, bro? The Chiefs said that? Tweets started flying back and forth asking him questions about the situation. Many of them had the @KCChiefs Twitter handle included. Even some local Kansas City sportscasters started asking him, hey, @TW, is this real? Did the Chiefs really tweet that to you? The response? Yes. And then, the Chiefs blocked Travis's @TW account on Twitter. When they blocked Travis, he could no longer see their public tweets, and any private tweets they had between them disappeared. Now, that made him angry. Digital bit. You don't want to add fuel to the fire on social media without a clear understanding of the unintended consequences that may ensue. Try to de-escalate, or do nothing at all. After being blocked from his beloved team on Twitter, Travis decided to teach them a lesson for their lack of digital sense. The first thing that Travis did was go to reddit.com and to the NFL subreddit, reddit.com/r/NFL, and he posted his rant. @KCChiefs Twitter account tells fan, me, to get a clue and stop being a fan. Submitted September 11, 2012 by TW. The KC Chiefs just blocked me on Twitter, @TW. Last night, I tweeted that for the fourth year in a row, the Chiefs are at the bottom of salary cap spending and that the owner, Clark Hunt, is hoarding cap dollars. The Chiefs' commitment to mediocrity has made me not care much about being a fan. 1. My first tweet to them. 2. They responded with this direct message. You can see my tweet and the direct message in the screen caps. 3. I responded that it's good to know that the KC Chiefs have an immature teenager running their social media. 4. Then they blocked my account. I, as a fan for my whole life of nearly 40 years who has never seen the Chiefs in a Super Bowl, nor have I seen a playoff win in nearly 20 years, nor have I seen a quarterback drafted, edit, in the first round, in the last 27 years. Chiefs fans have a right to be pissed. The Kansas City Chiefs have no right to be pissy toward the fans. We are the ones paying for their salaries. Shame on you, Chiefs. Oh, and congrats on 50 years of being in KC. 10 years of greatness followed by 40 years of pathetic profiteering. Clark Hunt sits in Dallas, siphoning Kansas City dollars. Keep in mind the customer's fan perspective as context for this situation. The Chiefs had not drafted a quarterback since 1983, and it was 2012. The Chiefs hadn't won a playoff game since 1993. They were in the middle of a nearly 20-year playoff win drought. The Chiefs lost 7 playoff games in a row, and they were spending millions below the salary cap. Early in the 2012 season, when Travis sent the tweet, The announced amount under the cap was $26.6 million. It was later adjusted to $16.1 million. In 2011, when there was no salary cap or salary floor, the Chiefs spent the least in player salaries. Beginning in 2013, teams had to spend at least 89% of the cap or be subject to penalties. The NFL football is serious business to paying fans in America, and being under the salary cap for multiple years in a row had angered many Kansas City Chiefs fans. The rant made the front page of Reddit. Some readers were mad at the Chiefs. Some were mad at Travis, calling him many different colorful terms. The story began to go viral because of this activity. Once it made the front page of Reddit, the social media shitstorm gained strength and started being referenced on big news sites and the local media. One local disc jockey in Kansas City named Laszlo started going off about the situation on his broadcast that day. Laszlo had a show called The Church of Laszlo in the afternoon in the Kansas City market. He was yelling about how people behind their computer screens are keyboard warriors, how weak and ridiculous they are. Laszlo said on air, paraphrasing, "The internet trolls would never talk like that in public, like they do on the internet. That ass clown on Reddit who was talking about the Kansas City Chiefs' rude tweet today? Oh, they told him to get a clue. Boo-hoo! Big freaking deal." One of TW's buddies called him up and said, "Hey, Travis, Laszlo's talking about you and your Reddit post and the Chiefs' deal. You should call into the station and chat with him." So, Travis did. He couldn't get through the phone line, so he sent a text to the Church of Laszlo show saying, "Hey, this is Travis Wright at TW, the guy who got the tweet from the Chiefs, and if you want to have a conversation, let's do it." Laszlo called Travis, and immediately they were on the air. In the digital world of media today, it's all about attention and trust, and Laszlo couldn't pass up the chance to hype the story for his show's gain. Laszlo was chomping at the bit to destroy an internet troll, live and on the air. At first, he was echoing some comments from Redditors, trying to make Travis look like a whiny idiot. It was clear that he had an angsty attitude about keyboard warriors and disdain for internet trolls, who are always louder and braver behind a keyboard. Little did Laszlo know that Travis is that loud in real life, too. On air, Travis stated many of the reasons why KC Chiefs fans should be fed up with the Kansas City Chiefs at that point. He mentioned a litany of strategic, management, and cultural errors that the organization had made. And while they were having this conversation, he actually started converting Laszlo to his line of thinking. Laszlo recanted, acknowledging how Travis was right, how it had been since 1983 that the Chiefs have drafted a first-round quarterback. The Chiefs hadn't won a playoff game since Joe Montana was the Chiefs' QB. Maybe the Chiefs were bad because they weren't spending enough on salaries. Why do the Chiefs not let the former players and alumni come to Arrowhead? Why are they hoarding salary cap dollars? Nobody changes Laszlo's opinion. Yet on that day, Travis did, with his own well-informed and impassioned one. After Reddit and Laszlo, Travis was contacted by local TV stations to do interviews about the scenario. It made Yahoo's front page. USA Today talked about it. Mashable wrote about it. There was even a segment on ESPN.com. When you have digital sense, you realize that page views are an economic driver that has forever bastardized traditional and non-traditional journalism and media in potentially irreparable ways. The 2016 election debacle in the United States proved this more than any other single event in recent history. Travis never expected the Chiefs to respond to him and tell him to get a clue. If you look at the comments of any YouTube video on the web, you see people saying way more rude and sometimes disrespectful or disgusting things about artists or brands than TW was saying to the Chiefs. And most of these comments are never replied to by the brand. As a fan, Travis had been to more than 100 games at Arrowhead Stadium. He was a loyal, paying customer. 100 games ain't cheap. A passionate advocate for Kansas City sports teams, he had been to every crushing home playoff loss the Chiefs had had since 1986. Them telling him that it's his choice to be a fan and get a clue just wasn't good digital sense. Of course it was his choice. It was also his choice and his right to vent his displeasure, as any customer can, when the product they support fails to deliver. Shortly after the 2012 NFL season, Travis spoke at the SMX social media conference in Las Vegas. After he shared the story about the Chiefs, a half dozen other social media directors and managers of other sports teams approached him. They all stated that the day after the Chiefs told him to get a clue, every one of those six sports teams had a meeting. They all told their social media managers not to be rude to their fans, and they began to institute formal governance around their branded accounts on social media channels. Digital bit. Don't feed the trolls. Also, don't feed the zombies, which you'll hear about in Chapter 2. The Save Our Chiefs movement. The situation with the Chiefs continued to gain momentum. The wave of public disgruntlement grew toward the Chiefs almost daily, and the compounding losses in future weeks did nothing to quell the rage. A couple of more losses into the season, and people from all over began to reach out to TW about doing something bigger. ChiefsPlanet.com had been around since 2000, before Internet 2.0, and was one of the few remaining independent message boards about the Chiefs. It was founded in August 2000 after a group of core users were fed up with the Kansas City Star message board moderators. After a negative experience with moderators at the KC Star happened in 2000, they started their own private community to commiserate with fellow Chiefs fans. Travis has been a card-carrying member since 2003. Message forums are a form of social media organized around communities of common interests. As a participant, you can really get to know people, over time, through the medium. There had been several Chiefs Planet in-person bashes and tailgating events at Arrowhead with members of this forum over many seasons. It remains a great community that commiserates over the 16 years of Chiefs futility. Chiefs Planet is still going strong today. A couple of weeks after the initial tweet shitstorm, Travis was perusing Chiefs Planet, and one of its users, Eric Grinnell, created a thread that said, "Hey, we're thinking about flying banners over Arrowhead Stadium before each Chiefs game. What do you think of this idea?" In another thread, Marty McDonald was setting up a Facebook page and a Twitter page for something he coined Save Our Chiefs. As they were talking virtually on the thread, it was decided to merge efforts. Save Our Chiefs was born after the fourth game of the 2012 season. With Travis being the disgruntled Twitter CC Get a Clue guy, he wasn't about to be the one on the forefront of this movement. However, he was able to give key strategic advice and help grow their social media channels rapidly. A fundraiser was created on Chiefs Planet for airplane banners to fly over Arrowhead. When it was all said and done, they had crowdfunded almost $6,500 to have airplanes fly a banner over the home stadium and parking lot before each game. Once the banner was funded, Travis reached out to his local media contacts who had interviewed him for the Chiefs Twitter story. He relayed the news back to the members at Chiefs Planet. "Okay, I talked with Fox 4 and told them Chiefs Planet is a 12-year-old forum, at the time, for Chiefs fans from all over the world, and the banner idea got funded and organized here. Other groups of Chiefs fans are voicing their displeasure with sites popping up like SaveOurChiefs.com and many other Facebook groups. People are becoming very, very vocal in this social age and expressing their choice to be a fan or not, LOL. They said they are doing a video news story on it, probably the 10 p.m. tonight or tomorrow night, and most likely an accompanying story on their website that will have the video on it." "We deserve better!" Exclamation point. "Fire Pioli!" Exclamation point. "Bench Castle!" Exclamation point. The first banner said. The local KC news outlets feasted on that development. Within 2 weeks, at Save Our Chiefs had almost 80,000 followers on their Twitter account. For perspective, that was more than the seating capacity, 76,416, of Arrowhead Stadium where the Chiefs play. The perception of having nearly 100,000 followers on Twitter freaked out the Kansas City media. It was 2012. News stations were still struggling to figure out how to leverage Twitter. They ate it up. They were like, "Oh my God! The Save Our Chiefs movement already has 100,000 followers and over 20,000 Facebook fans." The media freakout enabled greater visibility. Eric and Marty were being interviewed on sports radio stations all over the nation, talking about what's going on with Save Our Chiefs. Travis penned a letter and sent it to the CEO of the Chiefs, Clark Hunt, and the general manager, Scott Pioli, stating what the plan was and that the intended outcome was to see Pioli get his walking papers. Using email technology called Yesware, he was able to track all opens for that email. His email never got a response from the Chiefs. However, it was opened up 49 times on 27 devices in 13 different cities. The movement definitely had the Chiefs' attention. The group even worked out a deal with a local sporting goods company, Sports Nuts, NUTZ, and created custom black hoodies that said, "Save Our Chiefs, Blackout Arrowhead, November 18, 2012. On November 18, 2012, roughly 50% of the fans were wearing black on that game versus the Bengals. Save Our Chiefs literally blacked out the Guinness Book of World Records for loudest stadium in the world. The group had other more positive community events planned as well, like a food drive. They were partnering with a local food bank on a canned food donation campaign called Can Pioli. Phil Kloster, CEO of Edgewood Construction in KC with the username Phobia on the Chiefs Planet Forum, came up with that one. However, in a parallel narrative, that was the week that a linebacker of the Chiefs, Jovan Belcher, committed a double homicide suicide, which was absolutely tragic and brought everyone back to reality about what really mattered in life. Out of respect for all parties involved, the entire group ceased all of the Save Our Chiefs activities until the last 2 weeks of the season. The overall statistics from the movement were impressive. 41,545 mentions of Save Our Chiefs, with 359 news articles written about it, 160 blog posts about the movement, and 113 mentions on various message forums. At the end of the 2012 season, the Chiefs ended up with 2 wins and 14 losses. On the Monday following the last game of the season, Clark Hunt, the owner of the Kansas City Chiefs, went after the best candidate possible and hired Andy Reid as coach. He also hired John Dorsey from the Green Bay Packers front office as his new general manager. Former GM Scott Pioli and the Chiefs head coach Romeo Crennel and the coaching staff were fired and a new regime began. The Chiefs were saved. For fans, it was long overdue justice. Travis immediately sent Clark Hunt, the CEO of the Chiefs, a note of thanks. "Mr. Hunt, thank you. You've proven yourself to be extremely tenacious in getting your man, Andy Reid. I'll never call you cheap again. You've displayed balls of steel, went above and beyond, and as a result, KC fans are rejoicing, today, at your awesomeness. I put on a Chiefs jersey for the first time since preseason, just now. It feels good to have our Chiefs back from Pioli and in the hands of Andy Reid and John Dorsey. I love the Chiefs, and am grateful that we have an owner who cares. Could I be unblocked from the @KCChiefs Twitter now? Thanks again for saving our Chiefs, Mr. Hunt. You're a badass. Sincerely, Travis Wright, @TW. The day that Scott Pioli was fired, the Chiefs unblocked @TW and the Chiefs ticket department connected with Travis and offered him half-price season tickets for the 2013 season. He gladly accepted them and has continued to be a diehard fan. What started earlier in the year with a disgruntled guy tweeting a forgettable tweet to the Chiefs after a loss had snowballed into this major movement, all because one individual on the Chiefs' social media team did not use digital sense. Save Our Chiefs was a brilliant social media experience in that it showed how people can impact change when they handle it right. The idea was born from frustration. Create a social media experience to allow fans with similar thoughts a place to engage and interact with. Our movement became a cornerstone of daily life for Chiefs fans. We were talked about on multiple radio stations and local TV, and it drew national attention from NFL.com, ESPN.com, even the New York Times. The fallout from this effort was amazing. The Chiefs organization had a digital transformation. They listened to their biggest customer, the fan base. Sure, they fired their GM and head coach, and they cut ties with an overpriced sloth of a quarterback. We still relish in helping accomplish that. But that wasn't the amazing thing. The Kansas City Chiefs organization physically and mentally shifted into a fan-friendly culture. They rolled out Chiefs Kingdom, which serves as a universal rally cry to bring all fans back together. They were more positive in social interactions. They stopped banning people and started to listen, engage, and learn. In short form, it proved brands are capable of change. From a digital media perspective, the main takeaway here should be this. By creating experiences and publishing content that is engaging as well as entertaining, brands and marketers will build relationships with prospects and cement foundational relationships with brand loyalists. As someone who has been involved in digital media and marketing since the late 90s, I don't think people set out to be marketed at in the social channel. Rather, you have to apply some marketing psychology to your message through various types of engagement, says Marty McDonald, co-conspirator of Save Our Chiefs and Senior Director of Strategic Development and Sales at GO Digital. Simply stated, your prospects and customers simply want to be a great guest at the dinner table of your brand. Treat them that way, and they'll embrace your brand. Fast forward to January 2016. The Chiefs' 23-year playoff futility ended when they won their first playoff game since 1993. Saved indeed. Optus in Australia. In November 2014, Travis was traveling to Australia for the first time to speak at Ashton Media's conference, the Data Strategy Symposium, north of Sydney, in an area known for its wine, Hunter's Valley. It's a great conference, put on by Mark Abbey and his Ashton team. Before traveling, Travis sent out a tweet to his friend at Chris Brinkworth, asking if T-Mobile had service there, as he was feeling a bit unprepared for international travel and need to figure out his SIM card situation. The local phone carrier, Optus, was doing some social listening and tuned into the conversation. Paolo from at Optus sent a couple of tweets to Travis, instructing him to drop by once he arrived in Sydney and they could set him up with their prepaid options. Sweet, Travis replied. Nicely done. Consider this a conversion, Paolo. He then recommended that Optus connect with at Mia D, my former boss at Symantec, who was also speaking at the same conference. Well, when Travis arrived in Sydney, he saw the Optus store and was ready to buy a SIM card for the trip. However, when Travis walked up to the store, an Optus employee, Jordan Zack, said, "Hello, Travis. Welcome to Australia. We've been waiting for you." What? Travis was blown away by the customer service already. But wait, it gets better. Jordan handed Travis a huge Optus bag, and inside it were some Australian items, such as a six-pack of Victorian bitter beer, some flip-flops, some delicious Tim Tam cookies, some Vegemite, so he could make a sandwich, some other gadgets and gizmos, and best of all, a free 4G hotspot with 10 gigabytes of free data for the trip. In case you were wondering if they had a system in place to serve others this way, they gave Mia Dand a similar experience. Optus gave Travis the free hotspot, since Apple and T-Mobile wouldn't unlock his iPhone 5S. So they went the extra mile and hooked him up. Talk about digital sense. Travis has been back to Australia twice since then, and guess which phone carrier he uses. The moral of these two stories is that digital sense goes both ways. It can infuriate a customer or inspire them. It's also possible to gain real momentum out of your major commitment to redeem your organization when you have failed to have digital sense in the past. The genesis of this audiobook. What you are listening to right now is an audiobook that will teach you how to keep up with the pace of change, keep your customer at the center of your decision process, and inspire the people inside your organization to lead from wherever they are with more honed digital sense. Soon after the Chiefs incident in 2012, Travis and Chris were speaking on the same panel at the 2013 Denver Startup Week Festival in Colorado. Chris, a serial entrepreneur, was on a personal sabbatical in Colorado, mired in ethnographic research around the Fourth Industrial Revolution and customer experience following a venture exit. Chris and Travis immediately hit it off. In summer 2015, they reconnected, and the concept of this audiobook was born. Chris was back in build mode with Ethology, a customer experience performance media agency, and Travis had become one of the most sought-after thought leaders in marketing technology. Travis was working on building his agency, CCP Digital, was a paid columnist at Inc. magazine, and had a new podcast on VentureBeat called VB Engage with the incomparable Stuart Rogers. We had originally decided to write the audiobook and self-publish it, when serendipitously, a few weeks later, Leah Ottaviano from John Wiley & Sons Incorporated in Hoboken, New Jersey, reached out, and a deal for Digital Sense was born with the country's oldest and most prolific business book publisher. In this audiobook, you'll learn how to blend customer experience, social business strategy, and marketing technologies using the Experience Marketing Framework. This audiobook will teach you how to amplify that content correctly and give you some different hacks and tricks on how to look at digital. It will help teach your organization how to be more digitally savvy at an individual and collective level. We want Digital Sense to permeate your whole organization and the world at large. With over 3 billion more humans coming into the commercial cycle globally in the coming years, as mobile web and smartphone access proliferates in the third world, we no longer live in the information age, instead residing firmly in the age of opportunity. You have an unprecedented chance to capitalize and thrive, not just survive, through what Klaus Schwab, the founder and executive chairman of the World Economic Forum, has called the fourth industrial revolution. Having a model to cultivate a continually increasing digital sense will be an imperative. In the coming decade, the road ahead will not merely be a prolongation of the third industrial revolution, which used electronics and information technology to automate production. It will be a complete and distinctly different revolution, wherein everything exists as bits centered around velocity, scope, and impact as humanity enters a time of scale where technology has no historical precedent. Our hope with this audio program is to share some of the wisdom we've picked up during our collective 40-plus years of marketing and technology startup experience. We've unified our sharp tongues and quick wits into one voice for the narrative to make your listening experience fluid. You've heard the quote from Wayne Gretzky that says, "I skate to where the puck is headed, not where it is." That's been one of the guiding lights and principles of Travis's whole existence. Chris's personal tagline, for those who have seen him speak, mentor, or invest, is, "The real risk is doing nothing." Strap yourself in, and let's begin. Section 1. Overview. Chapter 1. The Game at Speed. Every second of every day, the rate of change is accelerating, and we all fall further behind. Welcome to your new reality. You will realize this reality slowly at first, and then suddenly in the coming years. As an executive, a marketer, and/or a founder and entrepreneur, you are no longer dealing with the convenience of saying outwardly that the customer is always right, while staying with the legacy processes and metrics internally as you march toward your next quarterly earnings call or round of funding. We now live in a world where the customer is always right and enabled by technology, platforms, and channels to provide unparalleled support for the brands they love in any given moment and to enact massive justice and vengeance in real time on the brands that violate their trust or abuse or take for granted their attention. We are already four compounding, exponential years from the dates of Travis's personal Save Our Chief story and 2 years from the Optus story. And we have just watched the most interesting, disruptive political race in the history of the United States unfold. We are in the crosshairs of a dying traditional media universe and the rise of the earned media era, where every individual is both empowered and feeling helplessly lost by the digital power and complexity at their fingertips. Time moves fast in the digital world. Why your organization needs a digital sense DNA layer. No industry is immune to the new rules of social business, the increasing demands, and the need to make customer experience the one metric that matters. World-renowned futurist Gerd Leonard has gone on record to say that the exponential speed and evolution of technology has created a digital-first world in which humanity will change more in the next 20 years than the previous 300. Think about that for a minute. Imagine it's the year 1717. 300 years ago from the release of this audiobook, and that you're hanging out with us over your favorite adult beverage in a candlelit tavern on Manhattan Island in New York. Imagine that as we fill up our bladders and make our way to the outhouse, or side of the building, to relieve ourselves, we notice a small hot spring on the ground, We decide in our stupors to take off our sweet powdered wigs and take a relaxing bath for the first time in weeks while continuing our imbibition. As we relax, Travis tells some joke about the British soldiers, making you laugh so hard you spill what is left of your beverage into the sulfur-infused bubbling water, and it transforms our hot spring into the hot tub time machine. Immediately, we are transported to present-day New York City, 300 years into the future. It could happen. Talk about feeling overwhelmed. We would have a real challenge, colonial skivvies aside, assimilating to the 2017 world with our 1717 understanding of how society is organized, information is proliferated, and commerce is done. Well, friends, whether Gerd is 100% correct or not, the reality is that all humans alive today will experience the same level of change by the year 2037 as our fictitious colonial counterparts would experience if they were transported to present day. In the next 20 years, with 5G internet, AI, AR, VR, chatbots, and the internet of every F-king thing, the world as we know it is currently going to change. Welcome to the fourth industrial revolution. Nothing before has ever prepared us for what is going to happen. As Wired Magazine's founding executive editor, famed futurist Kevin Kelly, also states, it's inevitable. Are you ready? The game has forever been changed. Your reality today is that your customer doesn't care about your internal battles, political hurdles, or legacy technologies' lack of integration into your newer cloud-based ones. She doesn't care about your struggle to retain top talent or your troubles creating a culture unified around core values while continuing to hit the quarterly earnings numbers. Nor does she care why, at different touch points along the journey, you can't seem to deliver the same brand promise she bought into on the front end. She could give two craps about your issues and is, like all of us, no longer loyal to a brand as much as she is loyal to the need for a solution to the problem she has in that moment. She grades you only on how you deliver against it and how consistently you can meet her evolving needs over time. Just because you've satisfied customers doesn't mean you have happy ones. Satisfied customers are best defined as those customers who continue to pay for the service you provide because they have not yet found another way to live without you. Think about that for a minute. It makes sense, but it's hardly aspirational as an offensive strategy. It merely serves as a temporary defensive one that can fool you into complacency because it doesn't currently violate the universal law of compensation. There's a universal law of compensation, you ask? Yes, there is. There are only three rules to earning the majority of the market share at any given time. And for those who haven't heard any of our earlier stuff, the law of compensation is defined as follows. 1. The need for what you do. 2. Your ability to fulfill that need consistently. And 3. How difficult or easy it is to replace you. Satisfied customers are not secure customers in tomorrow's marketplace. And you are vulnerable because of the false sense of security you feel as it relates to number 3 in this law. The reason is simple. If your customer is merely continuing to pay you because you fulfill their need consistently, taxicabs fill the need of rented individual transport, and you are difficult to replace, 2007, then once Uber and Lyft and so on get to scale, 2010, your satisfied customer becomes your disruptive competitor's happy one. Then the cycle starts all over again. Satisfied customers of Uber are now just as vulnerable to leave it if it becomes easier and more exciting to replace Uber with some other option for timely, affordable, easy transport. In the same way, happy lessees or owners of, insert your favorite automaker here, cars and trucks are a vulnerable asset the minute they decide ride-sharing is more economically viable and convenient than paying for a vehicle they only use on average 5% of their week. Companies like GetAround, Turo, and Skirt are renting people cars and disrupting the car rental business now. If you're driving your car only 5% of the time, why not rent it out to someone who needs it? The sharing, trusting economy is in full effect. And some simulations show that in the coming years, taxi bots could replace 90% of all cars on the road, drop commute times 10%, and open up acres of land for parks and public use, completely transforming cities with a marriage of mass carpooling and UPS delivery intelligence.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.